Hey everybody, what's going on? Welcome to Sit Down. I'm DJ Sixsmith. Laurie Segall here with us, 60 in 6 on Quibi. Laurie, what's up? How are you?
I'm good. How you doing?
I'm doing really well. So checked out your latest story on QAnon, and it's just fascinating on a number of different levels. And you're somebody that's reported on the internet for a long, long time. What was it like jumping into this story?
I mean, this one was fascinating. You know, I've covered so many underground movements throughout my career, the hacker culture and that type of thing. And this almost feels like everything kind of coming together. You know, every online movement you could kind of imagine coming together. And I think I walked out of this thinking to myself, this is so much larger than any of us are even wrapping our heads around. And I think that's kind of my takeaway from even doing this story, is saying, okay, this is like, if you could put every online movement in one place, like that would be almost QAnon to some degree. So it was really fascinating. And also looking at, I think, some of the misconceptions about it too, because if you're seeing a lot of headlines out there, but when you're actually talking to a lot of these folks and really kind of digging into it, it's different when you're actually there, if that makes sense.
So what's most striking about reality versus the way that it is portrayed, you know, all throughout the internet and in the media?
You know, I think there's so many conspiracies that are coming out of QAnon, and so many, it's down the rabbit hole of the internet where you can find truth like in just about anything. And I think that's very dangerous. You know, but in some of the headlines, you see these people as just these incredibly dangerous people and violent and whatnot. And you go in and you meet a lot of these folks, and, you know, it's military vets. It's, you know, suburban house moms, it's all sorts of people. And you really begin to wrap your head around the fact that a lot of people are following Q, are really going down these rabbit holes of the internet and looking for their own version of whatever it is they're looking for. And so you can't discount it completely, right? You can't just say, well, these are just, you know, these insane, crazy, violent people. Like, that's just way too simple of a narrative, I think. And it does it a disservice, because I think it's growing so quickly and it's going viral. I mean, Facebook, Twitter, all the platforms have such an issue when it comes to this. They completely missed it, I think, at the beginning. And so, you know, I think that would maybe have been my takeaway, having gone inside and spent a little time with these folks.
And it's also spilling into our politics. I mean, there's elected officials that are people that have been on QAnon that are talking about the conspiracies that are on QAnon. What do you think is the biggest impact of this now coming into our politics in a really major way?
Yeah, I mean, we looked at the numbers. It's something like 100 state and congressional candidates circulated the messages of Q. You have 91 Republicans, Republican, 3 independent candidates and 2 Democrats. 29 of them have won primaries in this election cycle. So, by the way, anyone who just says this is just something online and it's not going to translate offline, I just think that's incorrect. We're already seeing this kind of come offline. We're seeing people wear Q pins in politics. So this is happening. And I think the big question, and this is the question when I went into this rally, and to give you guys a sense, like to give you a sense of when you go into this rally, like they film you when you film them. Like there's this idea that folks in QAnon and this movement, they believe that they are the news, right? And it's a very... there's so much distrust of the media, and it's such a specific environment to some degree. And when you go in there, and I think the big question I had when I went in there was, what's going to happen in November? You know, and Donald Trump, to folks who follow QAnon, you know, Donald Trump is really kind of this the guiding force and the savior, right, to some degree. And so I said to a lot of folks, well, what happens if he's not reelected? And you'll see if you watch the clip where everyone just says, well, that's not going to happen. He's going to be reelected. And if he's not, one person said to me, well, that's up to the American people to decide if, you know, if we'll accept those results. You know, so I think that the big question is what will happen? And if he's not reelected, will they accept those results? And so there's so much, you know, will a lot of this online movement, will it turn offline? And I think that's a lot of the that's the question I had when I went in there. And will these conspiracies, they're almost becoming the internet's political party to a degree. It's almost becoming almost like a bit of a religion. And it is so widespread, you know, so much larger than the, you know, the incel community that I covered, the red pill forums that I've covered. And so I just think, you know, as we look towards the election and what happens, will this move offline and how will this play out, I think will be the big question.
I thought your conversations with some of these folks were really interesting, because you had the one guy who said, yeah, the military will get involved if the election doesn't go a certain way, or just a conversation about COVID, because you were in New York, you saw the hospitals, you witnessed it. There is such a distrust in the media that there are people that literally don't believe this. So what was it like really pressing into these people and trying to get the truth out?
I mean, it was so fascinating. So you're talking about this conversation I had with Dustin Nemos, who's, you know, who's very much an influencer in the QAnon movement. And it was just interesting because we're sitting across from one another, and he was just saying COVID is the biggest lie fake news has ever told. And we were going back and forth on it. And you know, it's something that's pretty personal to me and even the 60 and 6 team, given that we were some of the earliest folks in New York City that were impacted by our team. And watching and the camera guys who shot this interview were folks who have been in the hospital shooting, who have been on the front lines of this. So sitting across from someone who was saying that this was all a lie and that the hospitals were empty, when the crew that was shooting this were the people who were inside the hospitals, when I had friends who passed away, it was not only was it kind of a back and forth on truth, but it was very personal, I think, to me. And so, you know, in a respectful way, we just went back and forth. And you'll watch this exchange and you almost feel like you're watching two different people who have two completely different versions of reality. And I think it's an important exchange to watch, because I think it's important for us to realize that that exists right now, that there is so much distrust in mainstream media. You add to that, that these algorithms on the internet, and I've covered the internet for 10 years, have bolstered misinformation and the spread of misinformation. And then you add to this a pandemic where people have been looking online, and you know, it's almost this perfect storm for everything that's happened, and it's playing out in this very aggressive way. So that was a really interesting conversation to have. And it was almost, you know, you can't let it go, right? You can't just let someone say something, you know, and so we just kept going and going in kind of a different that way, but it was an interesting, and I think that's a lot of the folks. You know, you go into these communities, it was really interesting. You heard people get up to the mic when we were at this QAnon rally, like, and say, well, I heard this and I heard this. And it's this idea of people who no longer trust mainstream media, who no longer trust what they see, who, you know, find one thing and they say, well, could this be true? And could this be true? And they look for clues in all these different places. And it's almost, there's a gamification of conspiracy theories. And it's almost kind of a fun game they're playing on the internet to some degree. So it's, I mean, it truly is fascinating and important to look at, because it's growing so much. Even posting a photo from the QAnon rally, I had folks I know from Atlanta, I'm from Atlanta, Georgia, reach out, be like, my mom has joined, or, you know, this is separating me and my fiance, and I broke up because she was, you know, she was talking about this. So I really get the sense that this isn't just some fringe group, you know, that it's much more widespread than we're giving it credit for.
Do you think, given all of that, that QAnon is here to stay, or at some point it will fizzle out, sort of like some of these other groups you've covered in the past?
It's a really good question. You know, I was speaking to one of our experts who covers, who has studied domestic terrorism and has studied a lot of extremist groups. And he, what he said was, it'll be interesting to see what happens with the election. You know, if Donald Trump is not reelected, and this is kind of their, you know, guiding force, and if these predictions don't continue to come true. But I, you know what, I just don't know. I get the sense, even having put this piece out here and seeing a lot of the response from QAnon supporters, it is unlike, you know, and even just how they're speaking to me, it is unlike anything I've ever experienced. So I get the sense that we've almost reached a new point in the internet and politics and culture in this moment in society, and it has given birth to Q. And I think whatever form, you know, Q stays in, Q, I think in some capacity will remain or morph into something new. And it's going to be a problem for the tech companies to get on top of. And the tech companies are always playing catch up. We all know this, you know, in kind of covering technology. And I think it is much more a human and society problem. So I do think to some degree, Q, in whatever form it takes, will be here to stay.
Yeah, I don't think it's going anywhere anytime soon. Laurie, really appreciate the time. Yeah. Great reporting. Thanks so much. We'll talk to you down the road. All right.